Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hatred, Understanding Our Most Dangerous Emotion, by Berit Brogaard, read by Janet Metzger. Prologue. Or, Wishing Your Son Were Never Born. In today's hate-infused society, hate has garnered a bad reputation. The mere mention of this complex emotion often triggers grisly images of psychopathic serial killers, torch-bearing neo-Nazis, mass shooters, or hijacking terrorists. The virulent hatred sown by cable news and social media has caused massive political polarization. But is hatred purely a bad thing? Or is it more complex than that, even sometimes a good thing? My hope is that this book will provide a more nuanced picture of this complicated emotion. I argue that it isn't hatred that's the enemy, but its lack of justification. In a 2014 New Yorker interview, Peter Lanza, the father of Adam Lanza, the Newtown, Connecticut school shooter, said that he wished his son had never been born. He added that he could no longer look at photos of Adam once it dawned on him that no one could be more evil than his boy. For a father to find the courage to openly express this level of animosity toward a killer when said killer is his own son is not only rare, but also admirable. Peter Lanza's words are an expression, if not of hate, then at least of an attitude reminiscent of hate. But if we applaud Peter Lanza for taking this attitude toward his own offspring and expressing sympathy for his son's victims, then hate cannot always be the deeply destructive emotional state that it is often made out to be. This is one of the sentiments I hope to be able to bring to the fore with this book. Usually, hate isn't a laudable emotional state. Hate that spurs atrocities like genocide, mass shootings, and other violent attacks on innocent minorities is never justified. It rides roughshod over details. 99.99% of group hate is based on sweeping generalizations, the kinds that reek of logical fallacy. The persistent hatred toward Native Americans today, for example, is rooted in myths, stereotypes, and palpable truths, like the falsehoods that indigenous people hunt for food with bow and arrow, that there are no longer any sovereign Native nations in the United States, that Native Americans aren't U.S. citizens, that indigenous identities are made up, that people can discover their tribal affiliation through a DNA test, that Native Americans receive financial support from the government and don't need to pay for college, that Native reservations are tax-exempt, or that Natives have a federal clearance for the use of illicit drugs. Although group hate could perhaps be justified in theory, in practice it never is. Personal hate, on the other hand, has the precision that group hate lacks. But personal hate that is dehumanizing, coupled with retaliatory wishes or not serving any worthwhile ends, is nonetheless still indefensible. But I argue that no such ugly facet is essential to hate. When kept apart from its mean-spirited siblings, hate can be a gateway to moral vision. The term hate has a multiplicity of meanings. When asked informally what we mean by hate, we often cite extreme versions of other emotions, such as strong dislike, stomach-churning disgust, dehumanizing contempt, or all-consuming resentment. While our everyday characterizations of hate, for the most part, lack exactitude, it is true that hate, in one of its senses, is synonymous with strong dislike. I hate fried liver. It has a mushy texture and a bitter iron taste. It's repulsive, nauseating, vile. When I say I hate fried liver, I obviously don't intend to convey that I think of fried liver as a malevolent wrongdoer. All I mean is that I have a strong dislike for this old Scandinavian favorite. This is also the sense most of us have in mind when we say that we hate being put on hold, waiting in doctor's offices, getting a flat tire, reading work emails, getting by on too little sleep, watching commercials, except during Super Bowl, coming down with the flu, getting stuck in airports for hours, getting caught in the rain without an umbrella, or being woken up in the middle of the night by a false fire alarm. This book does not explore hate in the strong dislike sense. Rather, its focus is on anger and disgust-based hate directed toward individuals or groups. Thus restricted, hate has a wide and a narrow sense. In its narrow sense, it attributes malevolence or evilness to a person for her perceived wrong or evil doing. When not otherwise specified, I will use hate in this sense. In its wide sense, hate encompasses both narrow hate and contempt. This is the sense of the term most salient in expressions such as hate groups, group hate, hate monger, hate rally, collective hate, racial hate, hate crime, hate speech, hate campaign, and hate mail. Although contempt is not simply the result of filtering out narrow hate's raw anger, it can be seen as a kind of distilled hatred. Contemners, those who have contempt, are typically colder, calmer, and more callous in their attitude toward their target than haters. While the primary subject of this book is narrow hate, we will also explore the philosophy and psychology of contempt and look at how it stands apart from hate. There is one type of hate that I wish that I could have dealt with more extensively in this book, namely self-hate. I touch on self-hate in Chapter 4 in the context of the Cluster B personality disorders and in Chapter 6 in the context of female misogyny. But there is much more to be said about this self-directed emotion than I am able to say here. I hope to explore its intricacies in future works. The chapters to follow are divided into two parts. The first explores hate in social and intimate relationships, looking for an answer to the question of why our intimate relationships can survive hate and resentment, but not disrespect or contempt. I argue that where contempt creates an irreparable power imbalance, hate is tied to fear or reprehension, which the brain is capable of reinterpreting as thrill, attraction, or arousal. But this facet of hate can also make it a dangerous emotion that brainwashes us into hanging on to abusive relationships. When tied to vengeance or dark personality types, such as narcissism, sadism, or psychopathy, hate is not only hazardous, but also dehumanizing. Neither acts of vengeance nor dark personality traits are essential to hate, however. Without them, hate can have more commendable ends. The book's second part explores the inner workings of group hate. Why is group hate so prominent today? The answer is not clear-cut. In fact, the list of reasons for hate's montane heights is long and grim. Among them are the tendency for historical hatred to linger in societies for centuries, the spontaneous polarizing forces that can bias cohesive groups of like-minded individuals, and the rising popularity of corrupt politicians who distort historical records and exploit people's anxiety and despair in a time of crisis or social inequity. But even that is only the tip of the iceberg. Ever since the political philosopher Hannah Arendt achieved international fame with her theory of the banality of evil, most intellectuals have jumped on that banality bandwagon, arguing that haters, even when active participants in incomprehensible atrocities, are just ordinary people like you and me, caught up in extraordinary circumstances. David Cesarani, a historian, has taken issue with Arendt's theory, suggesting that haters aren't simply average individuals trapped in a bad situation. Rather, they are plain people who become evil when thrown into highly unusual and macabre circumstances. I find it hard to believe that heinous group crimes like slavery, large-scale torture, or genocide are primarily executed by ordinary people who are propelled along by dire circumstances and a handful of psychopathic commanders. The uncanny truth, I argue, is that in every society, a considerable percentage of the citizenry have malevolent or evil traits that need no more than a little extra nurturing and caressing to burst open and cause seemingly ordinary people to morph into heinous monsters. To put the point differently, I am highly skeptical that we would all have become murderous killers in kindred circumstances, which is the eerie implication of both Arendt's and Cesarani's philosophies. But we only reach this startling conclusion, admittedly in good company, if we ignore the fact that in a large population, there are bound to be enormous differences among people's personality and character traits, and this population-wide heterogeneity predicts that people will behave in radically different ways, even in situations that strong determine behavior. Deranged authority figures and hate mongers do have the power to unleash the dark traits that many of us harbor. But sinister character traits may only lead to evil doing once various enabling conditions are in place, such as an economic crisis or widespread social inequity, limited possibilities for upward mobility, political corruption, lingering ethnic biases, and spontaneous group forces like group polarization. But if today's hate crisis is the result of a wide assortment of factors, then there should be countless ways to intervene and prevent it from escalating. Politicians and policymakers, I argue, have it in their power to address group hate in Europe and the United States. One way is by regulating expressions of hate, not in the way it's currently done in Europe, but in a novel way that preserves the original incentive behind the First Amendment right to free speech. I'm not calling for radical restrictions on freedom of expression. In fact, I am an avid fan of free speech, free press, and academic freedom, and I am one with those of you who argue that merely giving every citizen a vote doesn't satisfy the demands of democracy. Democracy, by its very nature, requires that everyone has a vote as well as a voice. If we focus on regulating the purpose of speech rather than its content, and use novel strategies to ensure that more people have the opportunity to be heard, then we can preserve the democratic ideal envisioned by the framers of the U.S. Constitution and help prevent today's hate crisis from spiraling out of control. Or so I will argue. Needless to say, limited restrictions on free speech are not a stop-all-hate tool, not even if we start listening to our fellow citizens. The million-dollar question is what else Western societies can do to conquer hate. Simply preaching that we need to become more tolerant is not the answer. A promising strategy for pushing back against the growing far-right movement and its hateful narratives is to educate the young before it's too late. But that's a futile tactic for squelching hatred in the not-so-young and the youngsters raised by hate mongers. Luckily, there are other promising strategies for combating hate, some more long-term than others, for instance, electing representatives dedicated to putting an end to political corruption and mitigating the massive social inequality between rich and poor, making upward mobility feasible for more people, giving everyone a political voice, and adopting fair voting systems. 1. Hit me with your best shot, an anatomy of the antagonistic emotions. Personal hatred can overtake us so completely that it crowds out reason, drains our deepest reservoirs of self-control, and morphs us into murderous marionettes moved by invisible strings. This is the grisly lesson of the ancient Greek playwright Euripides' Medea. Medea is a former princess of the kingdom of Colchis who plots revenge on her husband Jason after her painful realization that he is making arrangements to marry Glauce, the daughter of King Creon of Corinth. Overtaken by hatred, she sends her children off to Glauce, her husband's wife-to-be, with some poisoned robes. Vain as she is, Glauce immediately puts them on. The fast-acting poison consumes the legs of the princess, and she falls to the floor and soon dies in excruciating pain. Trying to save her, her father gets poisoned and died as well. In the play's most chilling scene, Medea wrestles with herself over whether she can bring herself to kill her own children. Convinced that depriving Jason of his progeny will cause him unbearable suffering, and propelled by her obsessive thirst for revenge, she resolves to stab her own children to death. There could hardly be a better illustration of hatred run amok. Medea's rancor is so ravenous that not even her own kin gets spared. She is the very personification of all-consuming devilish hatred. Personal hate is not always so theatrical in its manifestations. Many of us hate in silence. Either way, however, most of us are intimately familiar with personal hate. It's built into our cultural heritage, the theme of immortal plays, poems, novels, speeches, songs, and sayings. But what exactly is it? Historically, many scholars have emphasized hate's elusive nature, its resistance to analysis or definition. In A Treatise of Human Nature, the 18th century Scottish Enlightenment philosopher David Hume argued that hatred is altogether impossible to define. Similar sentiments were voiced by the 18th century German philosopher Immanuel Kant and the British evolutionary biologist Charles Darwin. I am more optimistic about the possibility of a definition of hate. In this chapter, I argue that hate is a complex emotion built out of the negative emotions, resentment, condemnation, and reprehension. I further argue that disrespect is the component that unites antagonistic emotions such as anger, resentment, indignation, envy, blame, contempt, and hate. But first, let's have a closer look at the nature of the human emotions. The human emotions. Our emotions are among the most culturally celebrated aspects of our mental lives. Countless movies, songs, books, and plays have been named after them. For instance, Gregory Hoblit's 1996 movie Primal Fear, starring Richard Gere, Aretha Franklin's 1967 signature song Respect, Jane Austen's 1813 romantic novel Pride and Prejudice, and Edward Albee's 1962 play Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, to mention just a few. Judging by the number of results yielded in a Google search I ran in August 2018, sadness, pride, trust, hate, and love are the most discussed among the human emotions. Runners-up include anger, fear, jealousy, grief, regret, and envy. Yet the human emotions encompass such incredibly diverse mental phenomena as enthusiasm, nostalgia, tenderness, homesickness, despair, frustration, heartbreak, boredom, relief, and sympathy. There are also quite mundane emotions that don't have a name in English. To be able to talk about them, we need to borrow words from other languages, such as Schadenfreude, the German word for the feeling of pleasure directed at someone else's misfortune, Malu, the Indonesian word for the feeling of awkwardness around people of higher status, Kaukokaipu, the Finnish word for the feeling of longing for a place you have never been to, and Hygge, the Danish word for the self-reflective feeling of mindfully enjoying yourself in a relaxing moment. But even with the help of loan words, countless emotions remain nameless in English and some in all known languages. As the product scientist character Chase, played by Alan Eisenberg, puts it in the 2018 movie Second Act when asked about his rival, "Look, There are millions of words in the English language, but there is no combination that accurately describes the feeling I have of wanting to beat his ass with a chair. It's not just the language of emotions that's specific to specific cultures. The emotions themselves are also partially constrained and defined by culture. Just as your great-great-great-grandmother wouldn't be able to recognize a computational device left behind by a time traveler as a MacBook Pro, so you would not be able to experience jealousy, say, if we humans weren't in the habit of entering into relationships in which we feel entitled to other people's love, time, and attention. Without that feeling of entitlement, we wouldn't experience the threat of loss that defines jealousy. Our emotions, while often despised, are our most efficient free tool for monitoring and safeguarding our personal or social concerns. Although they can, and often do, misfire, they can also guide us in the right direction. They can help us avoid real danger, stand up to bullies, finish an education, restore social imbalance, cut ties with toxic people, make up for past wrongs, heal broken relationships, and recover from the losses of loved ones. Emotions are not simply bodily feelings like headaches and back itches. They are special ways of mentally relating to people, events, and objects in the external world. In trade parlance, our mental relations to things outside the mind are also known as attitudes. Perceptions, thoughts, beliefs, desires, and emotions are prime examples of attitudes. But only desires and emotional attitudes, or emotions for short, have a significant tie to bodily feelings. We sometimes refer collectively to our emotions as our feelings, and when aiming for precision in our portrayal of them, we instinctively enlist the language of touch and bodily sensations, as in this powerful quote from Sarah Addison Allen's novel, The Sugar Queen. Like magic, she felt him getting nearer, felt it like a pull in the pit of her stomach. It felt like hunger, but deeper, heavier, like the best kind of expectation, ice cream expectation, chocolate expectation. Emotions do indeed routinely surface as feelings, but the word feeling has a plethora of meanings. A friend of mine once related this anecdote to me. During his philosophy of art class, philosophy professor Robert Kraut had asked the class what art is, to which a student responded, "Art is when you feel something." Kraut instinctively replied, "I feel something when my double chin gets caught in a waffle iron. That doesn't make it art." The pain in your double chin, the feeling of your heart banging against your rib cage, and the sensation of a lump in your throat are bodily feelings, not emotions. You can feel your heart banging against your rib cage if you run really fast, and you can feel a lump in the throat when you have a sore throat. Attributing your bodily feelings to an external happenstance does not magically transform them into emotions either. Suppose your throat feels thick, your nose stuffy, and your eyes teary. You initially attribute these bodily feelings to the fact that your kid just spilled bleach on your leather couch, completely ruining it. But you soon realize that you are not upset. You always hated that couch, and now you have an excuse to get rid of it. The bodily feelings, the irritated throat, the stuffy nose, and the tears, are not emotional reactions to your couch being ruined. Rather, they are physical reactions to the strong fumes from the bleach. For your bodily sensations, the irritated throat, the stuffy nose, and the tears, to have been the embodied aspect of sadness, your brain would have had to interpret the ruined couch as a loss that impacted you negatively, even if only in a small way. Sadness's tight inverse connection to well-being or flourishing is one of its hallmarks. It is this inverse relationship that explains why sadness, as we typically experience it, is an unpleasant emotion. Owing to its ordinary unpleasant character, it's also said to have a negative valence. We can think of an emotion's negative valence as an embodied protest of what the emotion is about. For example, the negative valence of grief can be seen as an embodied protest of a traumatic loss. But sadness and grief are not unique in this regard. Other negative emotions work the same way. So do positive emotions, such as joy, excitement, or enthusiasm. Because joy ordinarily is a pleasurable emotion, it is also said to have a positive valence, which we can think of as an embodied celebration of the enrichment that brings it about, say the birth of your niece or granddaughter. How an emotion feels is partially shaped by whether it's pleasant or unpleasant, and partially by its accompanying bodily feelings, if any. Which bodily feelings come to be associated with the different kinds of emotions varies considerably across people, times, and cultures. Sadness, for instance, can feel like a fist reaching inside your torso and brutally ripping out your heart, or it can feel like a tiny sting, as if you had been bitten by a gnat, or it can feel like nothing at all. When you experience an emotion viscerally, bodily feelings alert you to its presence. For example, if you feel your muscles tense up, your knees become wobbly, and your heart drum against your chest, your brain may interpret this as fear. Although emotions are closely associated in our minds with bodily feelings, emotions are about what goes on in our body. If you are afraid of contracting COVID-19, this may cause your knees to become wobbly. But surely your fear isn't about your wobbly knees, it's about a possible future event, namely that of contracting the novel coronavirus. All our emotions are about things or events that appear to be external to us or separate from us. Even when our emotions are about the mind or body, for example, anxiety about a growth in your armpit, frustration about your recurrent headache, or happiness about your infant meeting the expected milestones, the things or events these emotions are about are typically experienced as separate from us. The aboutness or intentionality of emotions plays a key role in their classification. Indeed, different types of emotions are about different types of things or events. Anger is about an apparent wrongdoing or injustice, say being a victim of identity theft, or being paid less than your coworkers merely because of your gender or ethnicity. The thing or event that appears to have triggered the emotion is also known as the focus of concern, or focus for short. There is a growing consensus among emotion researchers that while paradigm cases of emotions are coupled with bodily feeling, emotions often occur in the absence of bodily feelings, especially purely intellectual emotions, such as intellectual doubt sympathy, for example, being sympathetic to a certain political theory, for example, doubt about the truth of a premise, endorsement, for example, endorsing a particular philosophical view. But it's not just intellectual emotions that may lack a bodily component. Your frustration when you realize you forgot your laptop as you are backing out of your driveway need not bring about any noticeable physiological response. Emotions that lack a bodily component are akin to evaluative perception, for instance, a diamond watch looking expensive, a roller coaster ride sounding scary, or a soccer player's stunt to secure a penalty kick seeming unfair. Emotions can also hide in the unconscious corners of the mind. This is another way in which emotions differ from bodily feelings. You can be angry, yet not be consciously aware of it. But you cannot have a tummy ache, sore muscles, or an itchy mosquito bite without being consciously aware of it. If you are not aware that you are sore or itchy, then you are not sore or itchy. End of story. Imagine otherwise. You're in pain, your doctor says after examining the images from your brain scan. But I don't feel any pain, you reply, perplexed. Your doc writes some mysterious symbols on a piece of paper and hands it to you. Here is a script for morphine. Take 2 capsules twice a day until our next appointment. Bewildered, you grab the prescription, but stealthily drop it in the trash can on your way out. Although the brain can process information about physical and emotional damage in the absence of consciousness, the notion of unconscious pain is a contradiction in terms. The notion of an unconscious emotion is not. When we hold on to, say, sadness or anger for a long time, we are consciously aware of it only intermittently. For example, if you are angry at someone for a long time, your anger may be lurking mostly below the level of conscious awareness, and when it finally makes itself fully consciously present, it may no longer seize you with the visceral fervor it once did. All emotions can go under the radar in this way. Even those most closely associated in our minds with conscious feelings, such as love and grief. Even when an emotion operates mostly below the radar of consciousness, it can nonetheless pop up and say hello when you least expect it. Trauma, for example, remains mostly hidden below the surface until a trigger yanks it out of hiding. Even when old scars are hermetically sealed off from conscious awareness, they tend to leave a stain on how we behave. For example, trauma is often an automatic trigger of avoidance behavior. Target versus focus. As we have seen, emotions are directed at things or events we perceive to be external to us. This outward directedness of a mental state is also known as intentionality. It is their intentionality that sets emotions apart from moods. Unlike emotions, moods are not about a particular thing or event. If you are in a depressed mood, it may feel like the whole world is against you. But moods and mood disorders are not about anything in particular. This distinction between moods and emotions is not always reflected in the language we use to talk about them. If you say that you are depressed, you could mean that you have a depressed mood, or that you are depressed about an unpleasable situation or event, for instance, graduating without a traditional graduation ceremony. When depressed is used in this latter sense, your depressed state is not a mood or mood disorder, but an emotion. An emotion's focus, a notion we encountered earlier, should be kept distinct from its target. If you are angry at your neighbor for not trimming her side of the hedge, then the target of your anger is your neighbor. She is the one you are angry at. She is the one you hold responsible for the hedge being untrimmed to the point of tipping over. But your anger is not about your neighbor. It's about her failure to trim the hedge, which is your shared responsibility. It's what the target has done, or rather hasn't done, that's the focus of concern of your anger. Your neighbor's failure to trim the hedge is the focus of concern of your anger. It's what concerns or bothers you. If we want to inform others that we are angry, several options are available to us. We can simply say that we are angry without revealing whom we are angry with or why we are angry. But we also have the option of explicitly mentioning the target of our anger, but not the focus of concern, or vice versa. "I am so mad at you," for example, explicitly names the target of the anger, but not its focus of concern. And "Americans are angry about face masks" explicitly mentions the focus of concern, but not the target. All instances of a given emotion type, be it anger, fear, or sadness, have the same type of focus of concern. This is what makes it an emotion of that particular type. For an emotion to be anger, its focus must be perceived injustice or wrongdoing, though not necessarily a moral wrongdoing like cheating, lying, or stealing. Sometimes we get angry with people who transgress epistemic norms, aesthetic norms, or cultural norms, like the norms governing professional soccer. If, for example, Cristiano Ronaldo deliberately threw himself to the ground to secure a penalty kick, this is almost guaranteed to anger members of the competing team. All emotions have a focus, Some have too. For example, one focus of hate is the targeted person's alleged misdeed. A second is their sinister or evil character. We return to hate later in this chapter. While all emotions have a focus, not all have a target. The focus of sadness is a perceived loss. If you are sad because your best friend Morgan no longer lives close to you, the focus of your sadness is the loss of Morgan's proximity to you. But your sadness doesn't have a target who can reasonably be held accountable for your sadness. Even if you were to hold Morgan's boyfriend Jake accountable for her move, he is not the target of your sadness. Complex emotions. Emotion researchers commonly distinguish between basic and non-basic emotions. The distinction was coined by evolutionary psychologist Paul Ekman, who achieved international recognition for his Atlas of Emotions, a compendium of more than 10,000 emotion-induced facial expressions. Ekman's basic emotions, which he took to be biologically hardwired, encompass joy, surprise, anger, sadness, fear, disgust, and contempt. Ekman labeled these 7 emotions as basic because they are marked by unique facial expressions that can be found across almost all cultures. For example, when your eyes are wide open, causing wrinkles on the forehead, and your lips are stretched horizontally, people across different cultures will be able to recognize this as an expression of fear. Similarly, when one lip corner is curled upward, producing a distinctly derisive or sardonic smile or sneer, people across different cultures will be able to recognize this as an expression of contempt. While the basic emotions have unique facial expressions that can be recognized by people pan-culturally, there are many other ways basic emotions can be expressed. The expressions of 2 distinct basic emotions can even be almost indistinguishable. For example, we sometimes cry when we are happy, smile when we are angry, and laugh when we are nervous. Psychologist Oriana Arajon and her colleagues found that when we are in the grip of an overwhelming emotion, dissonance in how it's expressed can lower its intensity and help us regain control. Dissonant emotional expressions are not ubiquitous, however, but vary substantially cross-culturally, which lends support to the thesis that the culture we live in shapes both our emotions and their expressions. Unlike basic emotions, non-basic emotions such as hate, envy, jealousy, grief, trust, nostalgia, and loneliness are not expressed in a unique or ubiquitous way. Grief is a paradigm example of a non-basic emotion that is conceptualized and expressed differently cross-culturally. As emotions are categorized on the basis of their focus, they have the same focus across all cultures, which in the case of grief is traumatic loss. In spite of the fact that traumatic loss is the focus of grief across all cultures, grief isn't the same everywhere. Culture shapes what types of loss are perceived as traumatic, how people interpret the concept of a traumatic loss, and how they react to it. For example, in Orthodox Islamic cultures, it is permissible for a man to request a divorce, but according to Orthodox teachings, divorce is the most despised of permissible acts by God and can therefore be more traumatic than death. Grief is also displayed differently cross-culturally. Grand emotional displays of grief, for example, are frowned upon in some cultures, but encouraged in others. In European Catholic and Protestant traditions, it's customary for people to grieve quietly and stoically, whereas African, Caribbean, and Islamic cultures encourage showing grief openly, for example, by crying loudly. Finally, the norms for the proper conduct of funerals and burials, as well as for proper mourning and memorialization, vary considerably across different cultures. Even within a single culture, grief is not associated with a unique facial or other bodily expression. According to the Kubler-Ross model of grief, also known as the Five Stages of Grief, first introduced by Elizabeth Kubler-Ross in her 1969 book On Death and Dying, grief involves five stages: denial, anger, bargaining, sadness, and acceptance. After the loss of a loved one, for example, you may first deny that the person is gone, simply refuse to believe it. Once the truth dawns on you, you may feel outraged and attempt to convince your beloved to come back or beg God or the universe's spirits to reverse their decision. Once you realize things are not going to change, sadness may set in. You may experience an unbearable visceral yearning for the absent person or the irretrievable relationship. Over time, you may finally accept the loss. These stages need not occur in this order, and each stage may occur several times or not at all. The different emotional stages can also overlap. After an unwanted breakup, you may both be angry at your ex and try to bargain with them. Or you may both ferociously deny the loss of the relationship and still cry all day long. Because of the complexity and its cultural and individual variability, grief is not associated with a unique, let alone ubiquitous, facial or other bodily expression. The basic emotions, in Ekman's sense, should not be confused with what we call the simple emotions. Simple emotions are not composed of other emotions. Complex emotions, by contrast, have other emotions and attitudes as parts. Resentment, disappointment, regret, jealousy, and grief are examples of complex emotions. Resentment, for example, is composed of blame and anger, and disappointment is thwarted expectations coupled with low levels of sadness. Which emotions are simple is still up for debate. One suggestion is that all and only the basic emotions are simple. However, there is evidence to suggest otherwise. As philosopher Jesse Prince has argued, at least some of Ekman's basic or universally recognizable emotions are complex. Surprise, for example, can be divided into a positive sense of interest or wonder and a low level of panic, and anger can be analyzed as aggression combined with goal frustration. Contempt, which Ekman classified as a basic emotion some years after he created his original list, also fails to qualify as simple. Psychologists have argued that contempt is anger coupled with disgust, citing the evidence that contempt's characteristic facial expression partially overlaps with the characteristic facial expressions of anger and disgust. However, the cited evidence is lending equal support for contempt as a blend of disgust and condemnation. I develop this idea later in this chapter. The antagonistic emotions. Let's now turn to what I call the antagonistic emotions. They include emotions like blame, anger, resentment, indignation, envy, disrespect, disgust, contempt, and hatred. This list is not exhaustive. Emotions such as annoyance, vengefulness, and schadenfreude are also antagonistic. But the emotions on the former list are the ones that are most relevant to the analysis of hate. The antagonistic emotions target people or groups. Not all forms of anger and disgust are antagonistic, but garden variety anger and disgust are directed at people or groups. Most antagonistic emotions have a negative valence, which means that we associate them with displeasure. Anger, disgust, hate, and contempt are examples of unpleasant antagonistic emotions. But there are also pleasant ones, emotions with a positive valence. Schadenfreude, which is pleasure in response to another person's misfortune, is a prime example. Three key features set the unpleasant antagonistic emotions apart from other emotions, with one exception. One is that they are reactions to the target's perceived offensive behavior or practices. For example, if you despise Gwyneth Paltrow for her pretentious health advice, you regard her advice as offensive, and your emotional state is a reaction to that. A second hallmark of the unpleasant antagonistic emotions is that, with the exception of disgust, they present their target as blameworthy. Where blameworthiness requires accountability and the absence of a legitimate excuse. If we find person's behavior or appearance appalling, this need not involve an attribution of blame. In fact, it need not even involve an attribution of accountability. But the other unpleasant antagonistic emotions attribute blame to the target. If, for example, you resent a school bully who calls you ugly names, your resentment involves an attribution of blame. The third hallmark of the antagonistic emotions is that they all have disrespect as a component, which is tied to their inherently socially comparative nature. Contempt and hate stand out from anger and resentment by involving disrespect for the target for her character traits and not just her actions. For example, if you disrespect Bruce Willis for demanding over-the-top remuneration for a particular film role, then the focus of your disrespect is his action. If, on the other hand, you disrespect him for demanding over-the-top remuneration for all his film roles, then the focus of your disrespect may be his character traits rather than just his action. Let's now have a closer look at the subset of the antagonistic emotions that lie at the heart of the analysis of hate: anger, resentment, indignation, envy, blame, disrespect, and contempt. Frustration versus antagonistic anger. While anger is perhaps the best example of an antagonistic emotion, anger need not be antagonistic. For example, you may feel angry about how things have turned out for you, yet not hold anyone responsible for your misfortune. Imagine you are incredibly busy at work when your child's teacher calls you to request that you pick up your son who has come down with a fever. As you get off the call, you seethe with anger, yet you are not angry at the teacher, nor are you angry at your son. You just feel angry. This is an example of targetless anger, or what we call frustration. It's this kind of anger that causes children to throw temper tantrums in grocery stores and adults to kick vending machines that won't deliver. Venting machine may be a more fitting term. We also sometimes experience targetless anger when grieving a traumatic loss. For example, you may feel angry about the traumatic loss of your spouse without being angry at him or at anyone else. In the envisaged case, your anger is a kind of protest against the unfair turn of events. Unlike targetless anger, antagonistic anger is tied to accountability and blame. If you are angry at someone for something they did, you hold them accountable for what they did and blame them accordingly. Imagine again that your son's teacher calls you to tell you to pick up your feverish kid on an insanely busy day. You know rationally that it's not the teacher's fault, but you nonetheless lay it on her. In this case, your anger is antagonistic. By directing your anger at the teacher, you thereby hold her responsible and blame her for you falling even further behind. In its more sinister form, antagonistic anger is also known as rage or wrath. Resentment, indignation, and envy. Resentment and indignation are species of simple anger. Like anger, they involve a presumed injustice. Resentment and indignation tend to last much longer than a brief fit of anger. They can linger for weeks or months on end, perhaps even years, staying mostly hidden under the flimsy veil of consciousness, but occasionally checking in with you. In resentment and indignation, we react to a perceived injustice. In resentment, we perceive the injustice as personal, that is, it's an injustice done to us. Indignation, or what is sometimes called outrage, is the vicarious analog of resentment. When you are indignant, what concerns you is an injustice done to someone else, perhaps a social injustice. For example, you may feel indignation upon learning that the board of trustees of a company approved a 50% raise for its CEO, despite recently letting 200 of its workers go. resentment is closely related to envy. Envy is a reaction to feeling shortchanged. In envy, we resent the envied for a possession or advantage we wish we had. Suppose you envy your coworker for getting a promotion you hope to get. Here, you resent your coworker for being promoted instead of you. Philosophers sometimes distinguish between benign and malicious envy. Benign envy is said to be focused on the envier's perceived disadvantage, whereas malicious envy is focused on the envied's seeming advantage. Unlike malicious envy, benign envy is supposed to be morally praiseworthy because it motivates the envier to take steps to get to where the envied is. However, I don't think the comparative emotion that can motivate us to work harder is envy in its distilled form. Rather, it seems to be competitiveness or zeal. In any event, I will set aside the use of envy as a term denoting a positive emotion. Envy implies that the envier perceives herself as at least as deserving of the advantage or possession as the envied. For example, if you envy your coworker for getting the promotion you were hoping to get, then you think you deserve it at least as much as he does. This aspect of envy is sometimes said to be based on the envier's perception of similarity between the envier and the envied. There is a sense in which that is true. You are probably more inclined to envy a coworker who works the same job as you than you are to envy the CEO of the company. But you might envy the CEO of the company simply because you resent her for being able to afford a Lamborghini and live in a big mansion when you barely can make ends meet. Likewise, we are prone to envy celebrities and extraordinarily successful, wealthy, beautiful, or smart people. You may be more keenly aware of feeling delight at their downfall than feeling envious of them. But being delighted by someone else's misfortune, or what is also known as schadenfreude, is an emotional reaction to the failings of someone we resent, envy, or hate. As philosopher Sarah Protasi has pointed out, envy can occur even when it wouldn't be possible for the envier to obtain the envied possession or advantage. For example, if you are infertile, you may well envy people who have their own biological children, even though you can't obtain the envied good. In common parlance, jealousy is often used synonymously with envy. But they are in fact distinct emotions. Whereas envy is a reaction to someone else's perceived unfair advantage or possession, jealousy is a reaction to the perceived threat of losing someone you already possess in some sense, usually a person with whom you have a special relationship, to a third party. The two emotions are core themes in William Shakespeare's play Othello. Envious of Othello's possessions and success, Iago manipulates Othello into believing that his wife Desdemona is having an affair with his friend Cassio. When Othello finds out, he becomes sick with jealousy and murders Desdemona, and then kills himself. Envy, as portrayed in Othello, is closely related to what philosophers call ressentiment. The term originates with the Danish existentialist Søren Kierkegaard, but it was made famous by the 19th-century literary philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche. Sometimes translated as resentment, the term's original French spelling is usually left intact to mark its distinctive meaning. As Nietzsche was using the term, ressentiment is an unpleasant reaction to a perceived lowly or declining social status that prompts a retaliatory attitude toward those perceived as more powerful. As we will see, resentment, ressentiment, envy, and hate are closely related. Resentment is a component of both envy and hate, although hate can also have indignation as a component. Retaliatory hatred is furthermore often fueled by envy, typically envy that motivates the envier to lash out at the envied by harming them in some way, for instance, by destroying the good that is unfairly in their possession. This is what Protasi calls spiteful envy. Philosopher Robert Solomon sums up the thoughts of the spiteful envier as, "If I can't have it, no one will." Spiteful envy is the kind of envy that most closely resembles ressentiment, and it's envy of this kind that is thematized in Shakespeare's Othello. Envy is rarely a rational emotion. This is because envy's target is not typically at fault for having what the envier wants. Envy is a kind of misplaced resentment, but it can be rational on the rare occasions where the envied is responsible for having the possession or advantage you wish you had. If you envy your coworker for getting the promotion you had hoped for, and you happen to know he was promoted because he slept with the boss, your envy is rational as long as it's not spiteful. We will revisit the question of the rationality of the antagonistic emotions in Chapter 3. Emotional blame. The word blame is commonly used to refer to the speech act of criticizing someone else, whether it's done calmly or by screaming or shouting. But verbal criticism is merely a vehicle for expressing blame. When we verbally criticize others, we verbally express a negative emotional reaction to them. But we can blame a person without expressing it, as can be seen from the coherence of saying things like, "I still blame my wife for her betrayal, even though I never told her that." Private or unexpressed blame can be directed toward people we are not in a position to verbally criticize because they are dead or too far away for us to do so, or because we don't know them, such as when we blame Hitler or Stalin, or point the finger of blame at the parents of obese children, while we blame people who are incapable of feeling remorse, such as psychopaths. We sometimes use verbal criticism or scolding to correct the behavior of children, but this is a far cry from actually blaming them. The same goes for mentally disabled people who lack the concept of moral wrongdoing and people in the grip of a hallucination or delusion that causes them to regard their misconduct as an act of goodwill or self-defense. When you blame someone, you hold them responsible or accountable for their actions or the foreseeable consequences of those actions. But blame is not merely an attribution of responsibility. You can hold people responsible for their actions or the foreseeable consequences of those actions and yet not blame them. If your child commits a crime, you may take her to be responsible for that crime, yet not have it in you to blame her. But what is blame over and above a perception of someone's guilt? Philosopher Thomas Scanlon has argued that to blame someone is to take her to manifest a relationship-impairing attitude and to acknowledge that this gives you reasons to adjust your attitudes toward the relationship in light of this impairment, above all your intentions and expectations. Scanlon recognizes that when we blame people, we might also feel resentment or indignation. But, he says, this is not required for blame, in my view. I might just feel sad. A commonly voiced objection to Scanlon's account is that it doesn't seem to apply to our fleeting relationships with strangers. If a stranger steals your purse while you are sightseeing in a foreign city and you never see them again, no past, present, or future relationship is impaired, yet you may still blame them for stealing your purse. Similarly, if your sister is murdered by a stranger who is never caught, the killer didn't impair your relationship, as you never did and never will have any kind of relationship with the murderer, yet you still blame them. This is not a knockdown objection to Scanlon's view, however. Although you don't have a personal relationship with the thief or the killer, the two of you do have a social relationship. You are part of the same moral community, and therefore reasonably hold each other to certain expectations. For example, you can hold others to the expectation that we don't steal from each other or kill each other. Because the thief and the killer violated those expectations, it is reasonable for you to take them to manifest a relationship-impairing attitude and to acknowledge that this gives you reasons to adjust your attitudes toward your relationship in light of this impairment. This is so, regardless of your level of acquaintance with them. So, I don't think this objection presents a real challenge for Scanlon's account. My concern with his account is that it doesn't generalize to all forms of blame. For example, we routinely blame people for possessing attributes we happen to disfavor, attributes such as excessive pride, greed, lust, envy, gluttony, wrath, sloth, jealousy, cowardice, emotional instability, grumpiness, pessimism, obesity, poverty, unemployment, drug addiction, procrastination, impatience, incompetence, impulsivity, gullibility, ignorance, and so on. The first seven of these even enjoy a special status as the seven deadly sins. Despite blaming people for possessing features we disfavor, we far from always take them to manifest a relationship-impairing attitude by virtue of possessing these features. In many cases, it would be utterly absurd to do so. If, for example, you were to blame your friend for becoming obese, it is highly unlikely that you would take her obesity to reflect a friendship-impairing attitude. Even if you blame her for having gained weight, it would be ludicrous for you to take her to have done so out of a lack of concern for your friendship. How, then, should we understand blame? An alternative to Scanlon's proposal is to understand the emotion as a kind of inner protest. An account along those lines has been developed at length by philosopher Angela Smith. Blame, she argues, is inner protest of a moral imbalance the wrongdoer has created. If someone harms you intentionally or recklessly, they are acting arrogantly. Their act implicitly conveys that they think that they are morally superior to you and that they therefore have the right to treat you as they wish without fear of repercussion or backlash. They are falsely claiming that you are low and therefore don't deserve to be treated with decency and respect. Philosopher Pamela Hieronymi puts this latter point as follows. I suggest that a past wrong against you, standing in your history without apology, atonement, retribution, punishment, restitution, condemnation, or anything else that might recognize it as a wrong, makes a claim. It says, in effect, that you can be treated in this way and that such treatment is acceptable. The point is this. If someone harms you with specific intent or reckless disregard for your rights, then their action reflects that they falsely assume that your human rights don't really matter in the circumstances. This false assumption, Smith argues, calls for a response that can help set things right. You can set things right by blaming the perpetrator and thereby protesting their false assumption. If your blame is not outwardly expressed, the inner feeling of protest can nonetheless help correct the offender's faulty assumption in your own mind. Even when there is no true justice to be had, at least there is the blame. If you convey your blame to your assailant, this may inspire them to acknowledge that they made a false assumption about your rightful treatment. They can express their faux pas by apologizing. In less severe cases, this may suffice to nullify the reason you initially had for blaming them. Even if they apologize, they are still responsible for what they did, but they may no longer be deserving of blame. In more serious cases, atonement or restitution may be needed to set things right. Perhaps there are also cases where nothing can make up for what has already gone down. I am sympathetic to Smith's proposal that protesting the aggressor's false assumption about the victim's rights can help set things right. However, her proposal fails for much the same reason that Scanlon's does. It doesn't generalize to all instances of blame. If you blame your obese friend for her weight gain, it would be ludicrous for you to regard the actions that led to her weight gain as conveying false information about your rightful treatment. To be fair, neither Scanlon nor Smith is in the business of providing a general account of blame. But it is highly unlikely that blame expresses one concept when used to refer to a negative attitude toward a person who has injured you, and another concept when used to refer to a negative attitude toward someone who is, say, obese, poor, or addicted to drugs. Fortunately, we don't need to posit ambiguity. In the subsequent section, I propose a unified account of blame based on the notion of disrespect. But first, let's have a closer look at the different meanings of respect and disrespect. Blame as disrespect. According to a poll conducted by Gallup in 1999, the three people who enjoyed the greatest respect in America in the 20th century were Mother Teresa, Martin Luther King Jr., and John F. Kennedy. What exactly do we mean by respect? In his 1977 seminal essay, Two Kinds of Respect, philosopher Stephen Darwall distinguishes between two kinds of respect, appraisal respect and recognition respect. Appraisal respect is so called because it involves a positive appraisal of a person for her moral excellence on the whole, or her excellence as engaged in a specific pursuit, for example, taking the SATs or serving as an eyewitness, or a type of pursuit, for example, parenting, teaching, or cooking. The appraisal respect Americans had for Mother Teresa, Martin Luther King Jr., and John F. Kennedy in 1999 is a positive appraisal of these public personas for their moral excellence overall. When appraisal respect is directed at someone for her overall moral excellence, our attitude can also be thought of as a kind of profound awe. Americans revere Mother Teresa, Martin Luther King Jr., and John F. Kennedy. While the appraisal respect we have for outstanding public personas tends to be based on their overall moral performance, whether we regard someone as worthy of appraisal respect typically depends on how they perform in a specific pursuit or type of pursuit. For example, as a commencement speaker at the University of Miami's Fall 2017 commencement ceremonies, a tennis player at the 2018 Summer Youth Olympic Games, or a leading actress in the 2019 Broadway play Moulin Rouge. When appraisal respect is directed at someone for her performance in a specific pursuit or type of pursuit, our attitude is not one of profound awe, but rather one of admiration or holding in high esteem. The focus of appraisal respect is the target's conduct on the whole or as engaged in a specific pursuit. What it takes to earn respect within a specific pursuit depends on whatever standards are held to be appropriate to that pursuit. Even in pursuits that depend heavily on the mastery of certain skills, the actions relevant to whether the person is deserving of respect often go beyond the mere display of mastery of the skill, as it does in the case of Darwall's boisterous tennis player. While the player is widely regarded as one of the best in the world, he is not widely respected by his fellows, as he constantly heckles his opponent, disputes every close call to throw off his opponent's concentration, and laughs when his opponent misses a shot. Even when demonstrating mastery of a skill is necessary for earning people's respect, displays of bad character during the pursuit can thus cancel out even perfect mastery of the skill. But appraisal respect in a specific pursuit typically doesn't require excellence of character. A tennis player judged to be one of the best players in the world can be a little bit out of line character-wise without thereby losing his fans' respect for him as a tennis player. Darwall contrasts appraisal respect with a rather different kind of respect, which he calls recognition respect. This is the kind of respect all people are owed, irrespective of their specific virtues, sentiments, attitudes, or choices. In other words, recognition respect does not involve an appraisal of a person on the basis of their achievements. As the label suggests, to have recognition respect for another person is to recognize their inherent worth, where recognizing a person's inherent worth implies treating them with a minimum of decency. Because all people have inherent worth, all people are entitled to recognition respect regardless of their normative standing. The idea that all people are entitled to be recognized as worthy of respect lies at the heart of Kant's moral philosophy. According to Kant, it is morally wrong to treat people merely as a means to an end, because all people have dignity, where dignity is the word used as a translation of Kant's term, die Würde, the worth. Morality demands that we respect all people as dignified individuals, which requires respecting their fundamental human rights, such as the rights to self-govern, make autonomous decisions, and keep sensitive personal information private. It is respect in this sense that Darwall calls recognition respect. Where appraisal respect is a matter of degree, you may respect both Eddie Murphy and Jerry Seinfeld as comedians, but have greater respect for Murphy than Seinfeld. Recognition respect is an on or off matter. In this regard, respecting others is like passing a driving test. You cannot pass it a little or a lot. You either pass or you don't. Similarly, you either treat a person with the respect owed to all people or you don't. There is no middle ground. This is not to say that depravity is not a matter of degree, but only that a withdrawal of some but not all of your recognition respect in response to middle-of-the-road depravity isn't an option. There are other kinds of respect besides appraisal and recognition respect. In a short note of 1973, Joel Feinberg calls attention to a third kind of respect, which is the kind of respect we have in mind when we say things like, "My fear of the sea turned into respect. My sister's accident taught me to have respect for all guns, even BB guns." Or, "Your class has given me a renewed respect for the dangers of binge drinking." When making such statements, we are not saying that we are holding the sea, guns, or binge drinking in high esteem, or that we recognize their inherent dignity. Rather, the respect we have for, say, the sea, is a watchful or apprehensive appreciation of its perceived power or danger. To emphasize the fear component, I shall refer to it as apprehensive respect or just apprehension. Apprehensive respect isn't just directed at non-human entities, such as the sea, guns, or viruses. We often have apprehensive respect for people we perceive to be powerful or dominant. In the words of Feinberg, we express our apprehensive respect for people by trying to avoid arousing their enmity, or by attempting to placate them once they are aroused, or by arming ourselves and treading cautiously. An illuminating example of how apprehensive respect comes apart from appraisal respect can be seen in Mark Twain's 1884 novel, Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, where Huck Finn seems to respect his father out of fear, but disrespect him for the drunken, weak man that he is. As we will see, apprehensive respect is a central component of hatred. Let's move on to disrespect, the component that unifies the antagonistic emotions. Disrespect is not simply an absence of respect. If you have never heard of a person, you don't respect her because you can't, nor do you disrespect her. But you may also lack both respect and disrespect for people you inadvertently take no notice of or don't presently interact with. This is what the 18th century Scottish philosopher and economist Adam Smith was alluding to when he wrote, "To be overlooked and to be disapproved are things entirely different." If you overlook or unintentionally ignore a person, then you have neither respect nor disrespect for them. Disrespect is therefore not the absence of respect, but an emotional attitude in its own right. The three kinds of respect identified correspond to three kinds of disrespect, which I will call critical disrespect, dehumanizing disrespect, and hubris. Critical disrespect is so called because it involves a negative appraisal of a person for their questionable conduct. Consonant with the definition of appraisal respect, we can define critical disrespect as an emotional disapproval of people who have revealed themselves as profoundly morally despicable or as unskilled or detestable participants in a specific pursuit or type of pursuit. the critical disrespect we have for Harvey Weinstein, Bill Cosby, or Derek Chauvin, the police officer who killed George Floyd in May 2020, is a negative appraisal of them for their profound moral despicability. While the critical disrespect we have for despicable public personas can be based on their moral performance, whether we regard someone as deserving of critical disrespect is more likely to depend on how they perform in a specific pursuit or type of pursuit. For example, how they perform as a film producer, scientist, or participant in the 2019 Boston Marathon. Mark Hauser, a former Harvard University psychologist who fabricated and falsified data and made false statements about experimental methods in 6 federally funded studies, is deserving of critical disrespect as an evolutionary biologist, though not necessarily as a father or a tennis player. As for the case of appraisal respect, what it takes for a person to be deserving of critical disrespect within a specific pursuit or kind of pursuit depends on what standards are held to be appropriate to that pursuit. Even in pursuits that depend greatly on the mastery of certain practical skills, people may be deserving of critical disrespect despite mastering all relevant practical skills to perfection, as in the case of Darwall's boisterous tennis player who falls short of meeting the standards of the profession. Poor mastery of a skill can, of course, also elicit critical disrespect, especially if the failing or mess-up reflects partial responsibility for not mastering the skill on the part of the agent. The second form of disrespect, dehumanizing disrespect, is an entirely different creature. To have dehumanizing disrespect for someone is to regard them as lacking the inherent worth that entitles them to be treated with respect. To disrespect a person in this sense is to treat them as subhuman or a non-entity whose sole purpose is to serve real people. A non-entity. This is the term 44-year-old Sarah Packer used to describe her 14-year-old daughter, who became a pawn in Packer and her boyfriend's rape-murder fantasy. In an emotionless tone of voice, Packer testified to the court in March 2019 that she had gazed into her daughter's eyes while the girl was being choked to death, telling her it was okay to go. Packer didn't merely hold her daughter in disesteem. She regarded her as a mere tool for satisfying her and her boyfriend's sadistic sexual desires. The third form of disrespect, hubris, is an act of fearless overconfidence that betrays a foolish lack of apprehensive respect, often found alongside contempt for the advice of others. If you hold professional fireworks in your hand and light them as a way of showing off to your buddies, then you are displaying a particularly foolish form of disrespect for the dangers of explosive objects, a paradigm example of hubris. In ancient Greek mythology, hubris was an act of arrogance before the gods, which was avenged by Nemesis, the goddess of divine retribution. Let's turn now to the promised account of blame in terms of disrespect. To emotionally blame a person for an action is to hold her responsible for her conduct and convey, even if only to yourself, that you disrespect her for performing an action you disapprove of. If, for example, you blame your friend for becoming obese, you hold her responsible for the excessive weight gain and disrespect her for, say, eating too much and moving too little. Although blame can involve dehumanizing disrespect, I suspect that when we blame people for what they have done rather than for who they are, the blame is more likely to be critical than dehumanizing. Conversely, when we blame people for who they are rather than for what they have done, the blame is more likely to be dehumanizing. I will refer to the blame we direct at people for their flawed character as condemnation. To condemn a person for their flawed character is to disrespect them for cultivating or failing to unlearn the corresponding bad habits, to borrow a term from Aristotle. In his book, In Praise of Blame, philosopher George Schur argues that people don't deserve blame for their bad traits because it makes no sense to hold them responsible for being the kind of person they are. Although this is probably true for some narrowly defined traits, I am doubtful that it is true in general. The reason that it makes sense to hold people responsible for their character traits is that character traits can be cultivated through practice, as Aristotle argued. That is, the degree to which we possess a particular virtue or vice depends on how we choose to act across a range of different circumstances. To illustrate, consider a trait like being funny, or what Aristotle called wittiness, eutropelia. The sheer amount of online advice on how to be funny suggests that it is largely up to you whether or not you choose to cultivate wittiness, which is to say, it makes sense to hold you responsible for lacking wit. That said, we often blame people for traits or conditions that they are not responsible for. Fat shaming, which is fueled by blame and disgust, is a case in point. Obesity is probably rarely, if ever, the result of deadly sins like sloth and gluttony. Mounting evidence suggests that the culprit in obesity and comorbidities like insulin resistance and high blood glucose is chronic low-grade inflammation that has an environmental source. But if obesity is due to factors beyond our control, blame directed at obese people is misplaced, as it rests on a false assumption about the cause of obesity. The proposed account of blame in terms of disrespect seems more readily applicable to both moral and non-moral blame than the theories advanced by Scanlon and Smith. Scanlon, recall, holds that to blame someone is to take them to manifest relationship-impairing attitudes and acknowledge that this gives you reasons to adjust your attitudes toward the relationship in light of this impairment. This account works well to explain what it means to blame, say, a friend for betraying you. By betraying you, your friend manifested friendship-impairing attitudes, and this gives you reasons to adjust your attitudes toward the relationship, for example, by changing your willingness to trust your friend. But if you blame a friend for not being able to hold up a job due to her tendency to procrastinate, you are unlikely to take your friend's procrastination on the job to be impairing your friendship. After all, they may not have any bearing on your interests. Similar remarks apply to Smith's account of blame as a protest of the message conveyed by the target's actions to the effect that you are inferior to him and that his actions therefore were justified. This proposal works well for the case of moral blame. If a friend betrays you, her act of betrayal does indeed seem to convey that you mean nothing to her. But it would be ludicrous for you to take your friend's inclination to procrastinate on the job to imply that you don't mean much to him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.